Hello. I remember that we, when we started this series of lectures, the weather was pretty bad, and in between we have had a lot of snow, but now it's really become summer, and it becomes increasingly difficult to make the choice to go inside and enjoy the lectures. I appreciate that, so I'm very happy to see you all here this morning. Today we have quite an extensive program. Why we need to go ahead, and I also think that maybe we have to be a little fast today. But nevertheless, I would like to introduce to you a couple of books. So I'm not by any means promoting these books for sale, but I guess, just like I did as a student, you are also reading books different from the books you have to read in order to follow the courses. And some of the books I've read have provided me with some ideas and some insights which I would not otherwise have found, and I would like to share this information with you. So when it comes to the history and philosophy of probability and statistics, quite recently I found this book, which is called Chances Are, Adventures in Probability. And this is quite an interesting book, not only if you are interested in probabilities. There are a lot of other insights of general value in this book, and it also provides you with an insight to the history of the development of statistics and probability, and it gives you an idea on the role of statistics and probability in human and also in natural sciences. So I can strongly recommend the information which is contained in this book. Another interesting book is the book of Jared Diamond with the title Gun, Germs and Steel, which gives an extremely interesting perspective to the development of civilizations in the world. So it takes you basically from the year 50,000 years before Christ was born and brings us up to the present date and explains why the different civilizations in the world, they appear to be what they are today and how that all happened. And it also gives you an idea on how might progress in the future. And actually the same author more recently published a book which is called Collapse, which elaborates a little on the perspective for the future. So collapse seems to be quite negative, but from such considerations maybe also we can learn a little. The third book, which really has an interesting title, Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance. So how many of you actually have a motorcycle? There's one there. I used to have one, so we are three. This book is actually quite a lot about motorcycles, but also very little about motorcycles. But it has a lot to do with the philosophy of learning and the science of learning and science in general, and also a little about chasing your ghost. And I guess each of you, just like I, we all have a ghost which we are somehow trying to find. This is also a quite interesting book. Well, enough of that. Now let's get down to business. Today, the main interest of the lecture is to look more into the details of random variables and the how we can characterize random variables. We remember that we are using the random variables to represent the uncertainties which are influencing the events for which we would like to calculate the probabilities that they occur. This is the role of the random variables, okay? Now, we introduced a couple of characteristics or way of describing random variables in the last lecture. We introduced the probability density function and the parameters of the probability density function. We also introduced the cumulative distribution function, which is simply defined as the integral of the density function. We were talking about two types of random variables, namely discrete random variables and continuous random variables. The discrete random variables were the random variables which were used to express uncertain phenomena which can only take discrete realizations. The continuous random variables were random variables to represent uncertain phenomena which can take realizations in the continuous sample space. We also, so in order to describe these random variables, we are using the density functions and the cumulative distribution functions. But it's not enough just to have these functions. We also need to define the functions in terms of their parameters. And what we also looked at were the moments of random variables. And these moments could also be applied to define the parameters, or say the probability density functions and the cumulative distribution functions. So that's more or less where we are today. We are starting from that, and then we are looking at further properties of the expectation operator, which we introduced. We will also look at the situation where we do not only have one random variable, but where we have a set of random variables which we collect in a vector. So that's why we call it vectors of random variables or random vectors. And when we're dealing with more than one random variable, then we need also to introduce the concept of joint moments. So not only the moments for a random variable, but also the moments involving several random variables. I will also talk about conditional distributions and conditional moments. Now, if you try to think back on the basics of probability theory, which we introduced in the second lecture, we introduced conditional probabilities, if you remember. So for the situations where we actually have some information about some uncertain phenomena, the same applies actually here when we're dealing with moments and distributions. We can also introduce those conditional on information which we know. Now, then we move a step further and we look at functions of random variables. And we start with the very simplest function you can imagine, namely a sum of random variables. And I will show you a quite nice little result involving how to establish the cumulative distribution function and the density functions for sum of random variables. And then we're going to take a little leap, jumping to general functions of random variables and how we can describe those in terms of density functions and cumulative distribution functions. So that's the program. Are you ready? Or did I just kill you? Well, random variables. So we are dealing with the real world, and we are dealing with uncertain phenomena in the real world. And these uncertain phenomena are generating whatever information we can observe of the real world. And now what we want to do is to model the real world. And the means for modeling the real world is to try to represent the uncertainties generating these data which we can observe. And we do that by establishing probabilistic models based on random variables. And all engineering decision making is based fundamentally on these probabilistic models and the random in a sense, also the random variables. Now, the random variables we can then also use to generate outcomes, but these data which are generated on the basis of the models, of course, do not have the same kind of value as the real observations. But at least the information we have in our model should, in the best way possible, also represent the real world, and the data generated by such data should represent, in the best way possible, data which could be expected to come out of the real world. Now, looking at the expectation operator, what is the value of this thing? Well, the expectation operator facilitates that we can assess the expected value and also the variance of a random variable. So if we have some sort of uncertain phenomena, the two first characteristics, which can give us an idea about the uncertainty in the phenomena, a central value and then a measure of the dispersion, those are the expected value and the variance. And for this reason, the expected value and the variance are interesting to be able to assess. Now, by understanding how the expectation operator works, what we are able to do is to assess this expected value and the variance also of functions of random variables. And of course, this is of general interest in engineering because normally we are not just dealing with one uncertain phenomena, but the engineering models are somehow sums and products and other functions of, say, a set of random variables, uncertain parameters entering into some equations we are using to estimate or evaluate some problem. So it's useful if we want to analyze engineering models involving one or more random variables in regard to their expected value and their variances. And this is why we need to look at it today. And if one example, for instance, could be if we want to analyze the duration of a construction process as a function of the duration of the individual sub-processes. Yeah, so you can imagine that we have some construction process comprised of a lot of individual processes. And if we have information based on experience of each of the duration of say, typical performance of such sub-processes, then we can start to make statistical or probabilistic assessments and models for the sum of these sub-processes. And that gives us a tool, a framework for planning when we are dealing with construction processes or projects. So that was just to give a little argument why at all we want to consider this. Now, the expectation operator has some properties which are very convenient to know. First of all, the expected value of a constant, so of a deterministic constant, is simply equal to the constant itself. So if there's no uncertainty, then the expectation operator simply provides you the deterministic number. If we are dealing with a random variable multiplied by a constant, then the expectation operator works in the way that the constant just flies outside of the expectation operator, and we end up with this term. So the expected value of C times the random variable X becomes C times the expectation operator working on the random variable X. Now, as a consequence of these two first rules, the third one comes out immediately. So if we have the expectation of a constant plus a constant multiplied by the random variable, then the result simply becomes the constant plus, and now we get the constant outside the expectation operator like this. Now it's also interesting that the expectation operator is a linear operator. So if we have the expectation of a sum of two functions of random variables, then that turns out to can be written as the expected value of the individual functions added up together. So it's a linear operator. We will come back to how we will evaluate the expected value of a function now. The variance, we remember that the variance is defined to the second central moment. We introduced that the last time. And if we now write that up as we have here, then we have that the variance of the random variable x can be written as the expectation operation working on the squared difference between the random variable and its expected value. So it's a second central moment, central in the sense that we are subtracting the mean value or the expected value, and then we take it to the power of 2. Now we can, of course, we can simply expand a little this expression here, and we become this one here, and then we can try to look at it a little. We can immediately see that the expected value to the power of 2, this is simply a deterministic value. So we can, and we know that the expectation operator is a linear operator. So now we can split this up. So we can take the expected value of each of those terms. So that becomes first of all this constant, which is here. Let me just use a pen, if I can find the pen. I'll take this one. So first we have this term here, that becomes this term. And this term here, it goes down and we become this, and the last term here is what we have down here. So we see that the constant goes outside of the expectation operator. And now by looking at this term here, this is of course equal to the expected value of the random variable x. And that means that this whole term here, this whole thing here, results in what we have here. This thing here goes down here, and this thing here goes down here. Now we see that we have some expected values to the power of 2. Actually, we have 1 here, but then we subtract 2. So we end up only having 1 with a minus sign. So this is the result. This is now a quite useful little result, which we will come back to. Now, when we are looking at the variance operator, and we remember that the variance operator can be defined through the expectation operator. Then it's obvious that the first result, which is written here, namely that the variance of a deterministic constant turns out to be simply to be equal to 0. The variance of a constant multiplied by a random variable x. Now we have to imagine that this constant goes into the expectation operator, and as a result of that, this constant simply comes outside, can be taken outside the variance operator, and taken to the power of 2. And the final result, because the expectation operator is a linear operator, also the variance operator is a linear operator. Yeah, and that gives us now, using the first result here, that the variance of the first term, the deterministic constant, simply becomes 0, and then so we end up by taking the variance of b multiplied by x, And the result of that we get from the second equation, so we end up with this term here. So this is the variance of a linear combination of a constant and a constant multiplied by a random variable. Now I want you to look again at the expression for the variance of a random variable. And what we ended up with was that this variance, so the variance of a random variable, could be written in terms of the expected value of the random variable to the power of 2 minus the expected value to the square. Now if you look at that, and then you wonder whether if we now would take the expected value, if we wanted to evaluate the expected value of this term here, whether it would be possible just to insert the expected value of x and then taking it to the power of 2. So in this sense, insert mu of x here to the power of 2 and then subtract mu of x to the power of 2, and then we see that we get 0. And that points to the situation that, or say to the insight, that we can only, in the case where we are dealing with a deterministic quantity, so a parameter which is not associated with uncertainty, in that case we have that the variance would be equal to 0. Yeah, if we're dealing with some certain variable where there's absolutely no uncertainty, then there would be no dispersion, then there would be no variance. And in that case only we can say that we in taking the expectation of a nonlinear function, we can take that by inserting the expected value directly into the function and then evaluating the function in this way. But you see, in general, if we do it like that, here we get the result 0. So it only applies if we are dealing with a deterministic variable. In general, we cannot do that. So what does that lead to? That leads to the result that the expected value of a function of a random variable, for instance, like this. This is a function of a random variable. Here we have the function takes x to the power of 2. What we can say in general is that the expected value of a function of a random variable is larger than or equal to the function taken in the expected value. And this is an insight which is valid for convex functions. And this result is what we call Jensen's inequality. This is a quite useful insight, because if we want to do, say, if we are evaluating the expected value of such a nonlinear function, of course, if it is a linear function, then we know that the expectation operator is a linear operator, and then it's very easy to evaluate the expected value. But if it's a nonlinear function and we don't have the information which is required, or the equations which are required to evaluate in the correct way the expectation of this function, then what we can do is that we can take the function in the expected value, and then we know that the value we get would be smaller or equal to the correct value. Okay. Of course, the equality is valid for linear functions because the expected value operator is a linear operator. Okay, now we have a small little exercise, and it relates. So these small exercises, they may relate to any which lecture, but mostly we try to pick up material which we had in the last lectures. This one also go back to the last lecture. So assume that we have a bag full of pens, which I guess is not the most normal situation, but just imagine that you have a bag full of pens. And all you know is that we have pens of two colors in the bag. Some are red and some are green. And now you are asked randomly to put your hand into the bag and select a pen and pull it out. And now the outcome of that, the uncertainty associated with the pen you will be pulling out, what type of uncertainty is that? And I give you the following options. Red means aleatory, green means epistemic, and yellow means both. Well, I see there's a great consistency in the answers. I would say the vast majority, with a very few exceptions. There are a few exceptions. I see one green and two yellow. Let's try to think about this result. Now, I'm sure that when you think about this pulling out a pen and randomly selecting with closed eyes and whatever you can do in order to do it correctly, you imagine that the real component here of uncertainty is aleatory. But there's one thing you forgot. You don't know the proportion of the number of pins which are red to the number of pins which are green. So this uncertainty will also influence the uncertainty which is associated with the color of the pin you're pulling out of the bag. So imagine that you have to try to assess the probabilistic characteristics of this process of pulling pins out of the bag. Of course, it's a big issue if there are only red pins in the bag. If you knew that from the very beginning and you had to assess the probability that you would put in randomly your hand and select the pin, that the pen would be red or green, then this information, of course, would be absolutely crucial. Yeah. The other way around, if there are only green pens in the bag, then despite however randomly you select the pen, it will be a green pen with probability one. So in this particular case, where we don't have a clue on the proportion of green pens to red pens, then this lack of knowledge, this epistemical uncertainty, also influences the problem. Okay, one small additional exercise. It relates to the probability density function. And if you remember, we had the definition that the probability density function can be derived from the commutative distribution function through the first partial derivative of the commutative distribution function in regard to the argument. This is what we this is what we have here. Also, we introduced that the probability of an outcome of a random variable in an interval, the interval going from x to x plus dx, can be written to this probability here, namely that the random variable belongs, is contained in the interval x to x plus dx, and this probability is actually equal to the probability density function multiplied by the interval dx. Now, if you look at this expression, and I'm sure that many of you already heard about this in high school, if you let dx go to zero, then it's also clear that this probability that the random variable will be in the interval, this probability will also go to zero. And that implies, of course, mathematically or theoretically, that the probability of a continuous random variable taking a specific value is equal to zero. Now, we could ask ourselves whether this means that it's actually impossible to obtain by observation a given single value. And here there are three possible answers again. If you support this statement that it's impossible, then you should give me the red card. If you feel the contrary and you mean no, then you should give me the green card. Or if you don't know, then give me the yellow card. And remember, we are talking about realizations of continuous random variables. And I see a lot of green here. I see a little yellow. Actually, I see some yellow. okay. Well, no. No, in reality, would be the actual situation, and the thing is that whatever we observe, we only will observe with a certain accuracy. And that means that whatever discrete value we are observing, it's actually not a completely discrete value, but it corresponds to the interval given by the precision of our observations. And for this reason, we are actually always observing interval observations, in a sense. So for our observations, there is a probability associated with what we observe. Okay, let's take the next step. Now we looked at the expectation operator and we had a look at the variance operator, and we also introduced important concepts relating to the expected value and the variance of simple functions. I would like you always to bear in mind this Jensen's inequality, that we can simply not just take the expectation of a function by evaluating the function in its expected values. Remember that. Now, dealing with real engineering problems, we do not only deal with one random variable. That's very seldom, and therefore it's useful to introduce the concept of vectors of random variables or random vectors. In general, such components may be dependent. That means that their outcomes would also be dependent. Their outcomes may be correlated. And we introduced the concept of correlation already in the third lecture. Now, one example would, for instance, be rainfall and water level. So the event of a certain amount of rainfall would be dependent, or would be dependent also on not on, but say the other way around, the water level in Zurich Lake would be dependent on the event of rainfalls. So there's a dependency between those two uncertain phenomena. So it is necessary that we establish probabilistic models which take into this take into account this dependency. And what we can do in order to describe consistently such uncertainties and including their interdependencies between the random variables is by introducing what we call joint cumulative distributions and joint moments. So let's consider that we have a vector of random variables. As I have this one here. So now I write my capital letter X as bold, and that always means a vector or a matrix. So when I write a bold letter, it's always a vector or matrix, and in this case it's a vector, and I write it out for you so that you may see what this vector is comprised of, namely a set of random variables x1 up to xn. We're dealing with a vector of n random variables, and of course I write it here transposed, because otherwise it is not in the form of what you understand to be a vector, which is basically a column. Okay, so I transpose it, now you have a vector. The joint cumulative distribution function is given just in a way similar as we had it for a random variable. It's given as through the probability that the random variables x1 is smaller than equal to the argument x1. The argument is contained in this vector here. The random variable x2 is smaller than equal to x2. The random variable, and it goes on up to the random variable xn, is smaller than equal to xn. And now we take the intersection of all these individual events. Yeah? All these individual events is what is expressed by the joint cumulative distribution function, the probability that they will occur. Now, just as we had it for an individual random variable, we can develop the probability, the joint probability density function, from the joint cumulative probability or joint cumulative distribution function by taking the nth order partial derivative in respect to all the arguments. So we have the arguments of the function, those are these values here. So if we now differentiate this thing here partially with respect to all the arguments like we do here, then we obtain the joint probability density function. So that's actually a very simple operation. It's very easy to take the first order partial derivative of a function in regard to one particular argument. Now, in developing this joint cumulative distribution function, we simply do it n times. So one time in regard to each of the arguments. So we're just repeating the process up until the nth variable. So that's really not complicated. It looks much worse than it is, I would say. The next thing I would like to show you here is an illustration where we have a joint probability density function for discretely distributed random variables. This is what we have here on the right side. So this is the joint density function of two discretely distributed random variables. And what you see here are the probability densities. So these are the densities.
P, X, Y. Yeah? And of course, here I just provided some numbers. This is just an example. So these define the probability densities, those you have in this table. Okay? So this is an illustration of a joint density for a discretely distributed random variable. Now you can imagine that if we were dealing with two continuously distributed random variables, then we would have a nice function, like, for instance, the typical bell-shaped functions which you have seen earlier. And of course, if you take all these densities which you have in this figure here, and you sum them up, then of course the sum should be equal to 1. Because the probability of all events should be equal to 1. Now, for jointly distributed random variables, and considering the joint density function of a vector of random variables, we can define what we call the marginal probability density function. And this is defined for one of the random variables in the vector. So that would be the marginal probability density function of the random variable xi. And we can evaluate that by taking the joint density function for the whole vector and then folding this density function together in all dimensions except the i's dimension. So we are integrating out over all random variable, so over all the arguments except dxi. You see, dxi is not in the integral. So we are simply folding together this n-dimensional function over n minus 1 dimensions. And then we get the marginal density function for the random variable xi. Yeah? How does that look in this small example? So we were starting out with this joint density function, and now I would like to have the marginal density function of the random variable x. Here we have x, here we have y. So what I now do is that I take the joint density of x and y, and then I integrate out over all y values. And the way this works, if you go into the density function table here, where I've had the values defined, then for one value of x, namely 1, this value here, now what I'm doing is that I'm adding up the densities of those. And then I arrive at this value here. And I note this value, the result is this value here. This is in the x direction here, okay? Then I do the same for this. I note the values of these densities. I add them up together, and I get this value here. And I continue this process. I get this, and I get this. And this is now the marginal probability density function for the x variable. So this is the way of folding together. And of course, the marginal density functions, they give us some information about the uncertainty associated with each of the random variables, but it gives no information about the dependencies between the two random variables, x and y. Okay? Very often, when people are trying to describe uncertain phenomena, what they really have in their mind, and this is fair because it's very difficult to build up an opinion about an n-dimensional space,
So what we tend to do as humans is to try to describe the phenomena individually. And the individual description of a random variable would normally correspond to the marginal probability density function. But we have to remember there's more to the story, because this random variable, which we are describing the probability density function, implicitly the marginal probability density function, would most likely be somehow in dependency with other random variables. And in order to get the full picture, we would need the joint density function. Okay. Let's take a break. Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, we start this hour. The next 45 minutes, we are starting with, again, one of these extremely small exercises. Now, consider the situation that the profit you all want to make a profit, don't you? Is there anybody there who are not interested in profit? Well, then we would be willing to share. Well, let's assume that the profit is uncertain and it's modeled by a random variable x. And this is a profit earned by a contractor on a construction project. So he's trying to look into the future. And he's modeling this uncertain profit by a random variable. And this random variable he has defined through a probability density function. Now, this is a continuous probability density function, which is defined in the interval from minus 10 up to plus 70, and we are dealing with measures of $1,000. So it goes from a loss of $10,000 to a possible income of $70,000. And of course, this uncertainty is due to the combined effect of many individual uncertainties which are influencing the success of the project. Now, of course, the main concern of a contractor may be, what is the probability that this project will give me a loss? And for this reason, I would like you to come up very easily, very fast, based on this information, the probability that the contractor will suffer a loss. And you have a couple of options here. Red means the probability is 0.2, green means the probability is 0.02, and yellow means that the probability is 0. Okay. Well, what do we have? We have most red, and then there's like a green cluster, which is quite interesting. Maybe there's some sort of group psychology also involved in the answering. Anyhow, the right answer is green, is red, and you simply take the area under the probability density function where x is negative, and that is not so difficult here. That would mean that we would have to multiply this value here with the length of this interval here. So 0.02 multiplied by 10 is equal to 0.2. Yep, you got that? Also the greens? Good. Then we will proceed. Okay. Now, really, I appreciate that you might find a lecture like this a little filled with formulas. And, well, a part of this lecture is to give you tools on the basis of which you can do your own assessments. And you simply need, say, a minimum toolbox. And I recommend this is a really a good idea to have a minimum toolbox. I know the problem in my house. Whenever I have to fix something which has broken, whenever I have a problem with the windows who cannot close or something like that, I always go and I find my toolbox. And you can imagine my problem, because in my toolbox, basically, I have a hammer and a screwdriver. And that means that all the problems I can solve, for me, they look like problems which can be solved by using a hammer and a screwdriver. And as a consequence of that, the results are not particularly good, I have to admit. And also for this reason, I don't have the problem that the neighbors are coming asking me for my help. Now, the situation with you, it should be completely the other way around. It should be that you should have a toolbox which you can open whenever you have a problem, and you can find the right tool, so that when you have a screw, the only tool you have will not be a hammer. Okay? And it should be like that, that your neighbors should be coming to you whenever they have a problem, because they realize, they know that you have the right toolbox and you know what tool to choose. So, a part of this lecture is really to give you some tools, and I appreciate that it's not during the lectures immediately easy to see what type of problems really can be appropriately solved by any which of these tools. The thing is also that the tools are of a very general application. So there may be many different aspects of problems which can be solved by the individual tools. It depends very much on the problem you're dealing with. And these problems will always be a little different. So it's not that I can give you the example for the case where you need this particular tool. There may be many, many, many examples. And what you need to achieve is an understanding of what the tool really can do, what is the contents of the tool. And then during, of course, the exercise tutorials on Thursdays, we try to give you a variety of problems where you can see the different contexts where the tools can be applied. Having said that, I will introduce a new thing in the lecture, and this is a little exciting for me. Maybe not for you, but for me it is. It's also a little scary. So, you know, of course, in soccer, the sheet Richter, he has the possibility to show a yellow card and a green card. And then, please don't give me your red card. Yellow card and the red card. Please don't give me your red card, okay? But if there's something which I'm trying to explain and you really feel that this we could not understand, then of course it's because I did not explain it correctly or in a good way, and I can try to reformulate my explanation. If that happens, if you have a severe problem with something I said, then give me the yellow card, okay? And then I can immediately see that I need to explain something better. Will you do that? Green means yes, red means no. You will do that. Thank you. Now we are going to introduce what is called the covariance. The covariance between the random variables in the vector. And now we are looking at the random variable I and the random variable j. And it's a random vector of continuous distributed random variables. And this covariance is defined as the joint central moment. The joint central moment. So this is the expectation operator which we are using to assess the moment of random variables. And now, where we are used only to look at one random variable when we were defining moments, now we have here the random variable xi minus its expected value multiplied by the random variable xj minus its expected value. Yeah? You see the equivalence. If we were only dealing with the variance of a random variable, then the I and the J would be the same. So I would be equal to J. And then this whole thing here would cook down to XI minus the expected value of XI to the power of 2. This is what you have seen before. Now it's a joint moment, so there are two different random variables. And of course, if this is the definition of the joint central moment, then it's also very easy to evaluate this using the normal equation for assessing the moments. Here we have the joint density function of the two random variables, and now we are just integrating this density function over the definition domain of the random variables. I'm assuming that the definition domain goes from minus infinity to infinity for both random variables. And then we multiply by these arguments here. Then we do the integration, and then we have the joint central moments of these two random variables. And the result is what we call the covariance. And this is this thing here. Now, for the case that I is equal to j, of course, we get the variance of I. Mm-hmm. What we sometimes do is that we arrange the covariances in a matrix, yeah? And this we would call a covariance matrix. And in this matrix, we would then have the Cxi, x1, Cx2, etc., which means that we would have the variance in the diagonal, and then we would have the covariances, so here out in the, oops, let's just go backwards. Then we would have the covariances out here in the rows of the diagonal. So this would be x1, xj here. And it the same way down. And what we also have is that the covariance of xi, xj would be equal to the covariance of xj, xi. So this covariance matrix is a symmetrical matrix. Now I would like to delete this thing again. I have no idea how that goes. Let's see. Well, that's a technical problem. There's something called an eraser. We can simply delete. Da, 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 da. It's very convenient, this thing here. So besides a few red spots, keep. Oh my God. Okay, so another thing I would like to introduce are the correlation coefficients. And those we get out of the covariances. So the correlation coefficient between the random variable I and the random variable j is what we have here. Oh, now it goes really good. Is what we have here. And it's defined to the covariance between the random variable xi and xj divided by the standard deviation of xi and the standard deviation of xj. And for this reason, also, you may realize that the diagonal elements of the correlation coefficient matrix, which we can build in the same way as the covariance matrix, that the diagonal elements, so the correlation coefficient between xi and xi, they are all equal to 1. Because it becomes the variance, or say the covariance, no, it becomes the variance divided by the standard deviation to the power of 2. So that's, of course, equal to 1. The standard deviation to the power of 2 is equal to the variance, if you remember. Okay. So the expected value and the variance of a linear function is what we are now really able to assess. So if we have some sort of engineering problem which can be described by a linear function of random variables, now, for instance, looking at the duration of a process comprised by sub-processes which are following consecutively, and there's uncertainty associated with each of those sub-processes in terms of their duration, then we can build a probabilistic model for the total duration of the project in terms of a linear combination, where this is a deterministic value, and then we have a sum of components here with random variables multiplied by deterministic components. And we assume that there are n components in the sum. And now, knowing what we have learned, that the expectation is a linear operator, we become immediately this result here, that the expected value of this function y is equal to a0 plus the sum of the deterministic coefficients here multiplied by the expected values of the individual random variables. The same way, from what we have learned, we can assess the variance of this linear combination of random variables. Here, of course, the constant a0 disappears, and we only get this term here. Now, the variance of ai multiplied by xi, we remember that ai comes to the power of 2 outside the variance of xi, and then we are summing up over those terms. And now we also have to take into account the dependencies. They also play a role for the variance. And that comes to the products here with the covariances, xi. This is the covariance between the random variable xi and xj, multiplied by the coefficient which was used on xi and the coefficient which was multiplied on xj. And then we sum up over I and j outside the diagonal. So that means for I different from j over all components. So now we have a very useful tool. If we have some sort of engineering model which looks like this, then immediately we can evaluate the expected value of this function and we can evaluate the variance of this function if we know the variances and the covariances and the expected values of the random variables. This is the information we need to know then we can analyze using first and second order information. We can analyze the first and second order information of our linear function. And based on that, we can make evaluations of probabilities of events related to this function, which may be important in our engineering problem. Okay, we are also dealing with conditional distributions and conditional moments. Sometimes it's useful to be able to assess the probability of some event, given that we know something about one of the uncertainties which the event depends on. Yeah? As an example, let's assume that we want to calculate the probability that this project we were talking about previously, that this project will be delayed. We want to have the probability of a project delay under the condition that one of the sub-processes will exceed its planned duration by 50%. So that may be useful information during the project if we, for some reason, we get information about one of the ongoing processes in the project, and this information supports the suspicion that this particular sub-process probably would be delayed by 50% according to the original plans, then it would be nice to be able to update the probability of the duration of the entire project, because that would now be a useful information to have for the project planners, that they can make decisions in order to reduce the consequences of this. So, when we are dealing with jointly distributed random variables, we have a vector of random variables. We assume that, again, they are continuously distributed. Then the conditional probability density function for the random variable x1, given the outcome of the random variable x2, is defined through the conditional probability density function x1, given, now this sign here means given, x2. And we also write the arguments. If we want to do it in a way where everybody can see it immediately, then we also write the arguments accordingly. X1 is the real argument. The value of x2 is given. So the value here, with reference to the example, the value x2 corresponds to the 50% delay of one of the sub-processes. And we want to evaluate the probability distribution of x1, which could be the total duration of the project. Now, if we assume that we can start out with the information about the joint probability density function of x1 and x2, we assume that this is the basic information, then this conditional probability density function we want to assess can be assessed through the joint density function, this thing here divided by the probability density function of x2 taken in the value x2. So here, this is a given value, this is a and this here is the joint probability density function, x1 and x2, this one here. Now, of course, if x1 and x2 are independent, then we can separate this function here. We can write that as the density function of x1 multiplied by the density function of x2. Oops. X2, yeah? And then by dividing by the density function of x2, we see we can cancel out here, and then we get this result here. The conditional cumulative distribution function is simply taken from the conditional density function, integrated up. just like we do for any other density function. The commutative distribution is always simply the integral of the density. Whether it's a conditional density or an unconditional density, it doesn't matter. So for this reason, the conditional commutative distribution is defined through this thing here, integrated up from minus infinity to x1, the argument of the commutative distribution. Yeah? Please remember that this here is a given value corresponding to this value here. Of course, if we have a conditional probability density, or say a conditional commutative distribution function, then we can achieve the unconditional by integrating the conditional commutative distribution function up over the possible outcomes of the variable upon which we have conditioned, and then weighing with the density of the random variable which has been conditioned upon. And this is what we have here. Here we have the conditional commutative distribution function, and now we are integrating up from minus infinity to infinity over the variable which we have conditioned on, namely this variable here, and we are weighing with the probability density of this variable here. So we are weighing with x2 in this case. And by doing that, then we get here the unconditional probability commutative distribution function of the random variable x1. And this equation is also referred to as the total probability theorem. We are simply adding up the probabilities of this thing here. So this is the commutative distribution function. We are adding up this contribution over all possible values of the variable upon which we have conditioned, namely x2, this one here. And we are weighing by the density, so by the probability that these outcomes will occur. And this is what we have here. This is the probability of x2 in this interval, given by the interval length dx2. Okay. Now we can also define the conditional expected value, just like we can define the expected value of a random variable. And when we are dealing with the conditional expected value, then again, the way we do it is exactly as usual. We write it like this. So it's the expected value here of x1 given x2. So the expectation operator is working on x1 under the condition that x2 is equal to a certain value. Now, just as normal, when we take the expectation, we integrate over the entire definition domain of the random variable. Here, I assume that this goes from minus infinity to infinity. And then I weigh the variable x1 by the conditional, in this case, the conditional probability density function, x1 given x2. So it's completely similar to the unconditional case. The only difference here is that we use the conditional density function when we do the expectation. Yeah? It's time for a small exercise. Let's assume that we are dealing with this contractor again. And now he's planning to buy 3 bulldozers for a new project. And he knows that the probability density function, by experience, he knows this, For the number of bulldozers, X, which is a random variable, which will break down halfway during the project, can be described through this probability density function. So this is now a discrete probability density function giving you the densities of the breakdown of a number of bulldozers halfway during the project. So there's 1/8 probability density that none of the bulldozers will break down halfway during the project. There's 3/8 for both the event of 1 and 2 bulldozers breaking down halfway during the project, etc. Now, I would like you to calculate the expected value of the number of bulldozers which would break down halfway during the project. And red means 3, 2 means green, and 1.5. Hey, how can 1.5 bulldozer break down halfway during the project? It's a philosophical problem. Okay, yellow means 1.5. Now you're giving me mostly yellow. Does that mean I have to explain this again? Or does that mean 1.5? Hey, come on, we need more cards. And give yourself 10 seconds and use a pencil to try to come up with the right answer. Okay, I see mostly yellow. And of course, the right answer is yellow. So we have 1.5 bulldozer breaking down halfway through the project. And of course, it's very easy to calculate because we want to evaluate the expected value of this random variable, the number of bulldozers breaking down halfway during the project. And we can do that. It's a discrete random variable. So we sum up over the possible events of the number of bulldozers breaking down halfway during the project, which are, of course, the integer values here. So either 0, 1, 2, 3, or 4. And then we establish the expected value through the first order moment, namely the possible realizations weighted by their probability densities. And this is what you get here. The result is 1.5. That should be very clear. Now, in many cases, we are interested in assessing the probabilities of functions of random variables, and this is what we are talking about today. Functions can be useful for describing the events we are interested in. These functions define our engineering models. So the engineering models will be functions of variables. And when these variables are uncertain, we can model them by random variables. The simplest case we can imagine involving more than one random variable would be the sum of two random variables. And when we're dealing with such problems, it's possible to derive a very nice little result on the probability distribution function of the sum, or say the cumulative distribution function of the sum of these two random variables. There's also a more general result, which relates to more general functions for monotonic functions of random variables. We can also give a result, and I will also give you that. Now, if we could focus here a little, I know that this might look a little bad. I hear some mumbling. Is there anything I need to explain more? Okay. We really need to focus on this, otherwise it will fly over your heads. Okay? Consider the sum of two random variables, x1 and x2. This sum we call y. Let's assume we have the joint density function for the two random variables, x1 and x2. Now, in order to proceed, we make the trick. Let's assume we know the outcome of one of these two random variables, x1. Let's assume we know this, and now we want to analyze the probability density of y given x1. Are you following this up there? Now, assuming that we have x1 given, what we need is the conditional density function of x2 and x given x1. And we have just learned that we can achieve that by taking what we had from the start, namely the joint density function, and dividing it by the density function taken in the value upon which we condition, namely this one here. Okay? So this is now what we have. The conditional density of x2 given x1. Now that gives us a first means in order to assess the probabilistic structure of y. Namely, now we can write the density function, the conditional density function of y given x1 by substituting x2 with y minus x1. So y in the argument we take from here is now x2, and x2 we can isolate by subtracting y from by subtracting x1 from y. Okay, and this is what we have here. So now we have the conditional density function x2 given x1 in the argument y minus x1 conditional on the outcome of x1. And based on this, if we take this result here, then we can, if we take this result here, which is the conditional density function, and we want to uncondition it, then all we need to do is to multiply it by the density function of x1. Then it becomes unconditional. So this is what we do here. We take this here, and then we multiply by this term, and then we get the joint probability density function of y and x1. And this is now equal to the density function of x2 and x1 in the argument of y minus x1, comma x1. Okay, what in order to now get the probability density function of y, which is simply the marginal, then all we need to do is to integrate out over x1. So this is what we're doing. We're integrating this joint density function defined for the random variables x2 and x1. We are integrating that over the entire definition domain of the random variable x1. And so now we're getting the marginal, and this is the probability density function of y. What you can see here is also the nice thing that if the two random variables x1 and x2 are independent, then we can split up this density function as usual. Then we can speed up this function into these two components here. So, and this one. And this is what is called the convolution integral in probability theory. Now, you can imagine that in this case, we were only developing the density function for two random variables, the sum of two random variables. But now you can continue. So if you have a sum of n random variables, then you can apply this expression for each of the two random variables, and then you can group together, and you can continue to add up all the sum of all the random variables in the sum. So in this way, we can develop the probability density function of any sum of random variables for which we have the joint probability distribution functions. And it becomes especially easy if the random variables, of course, are independent, as you see. Now, there's also another result which relates to the commutative distribution function of functions of random variables. Now we are looking at general functions y equal to g of x. X is a random vector. And we assume that we have the commutative distribution function of this random vector given as this joint commutative distribution function. Now we need to differentiate a little. If the function g of x is a monotonic increasing function and represents a one-to-one mapping, so that it's a real function, one-to-one function, the realization of y is smaller only, is smaller than y0 only if the realization of x is smaller than x0, where x0 is evaluated through the inverse of the function of y0. Now, I think I said the vector x here, but that's not true. It's a scalar, okay? It's not a vector, it's only a scalar. So this is a function on a random variable, and it's a monotonic function. And it's a one-to-one mapping from x to y. So if we have that, the important thing here is that to realize that the realization of the random variable y can only be smaller than y0 if x0, the realization of x, where x0 is given as the inverse function taken in y0. In that case, we can write the probability, the commutative distribution function of y, which we can always just write up as the probability that y is smaller or equal to y, the argument. That becomes the probability that x is smaller than or equal to the inverse function taken in y. And then in that case, we have that the commutative distribution function for y can be written in terms of the commutative distribution function for x taken in the inverse function of y with argument. Yeah? Now, of course, if that's the case, then it's also easy to develop the density function because we simply take that through the first order partial derivative of this function here with respect to the argument y. So this is what we have here. And then we realize that this we can write because now we have a combined function, and when we take the first order derivative, we have to do it in two factors. The first factor is simply the first order partial derivative of the distribution function, which is the density function taken in y, and this we become here.
No, sorry, this we become here. And the other term is the first order partial derivative of the function inside the commutative distribution function. And this is a term we have here. Okay? And now, looking at this term here, we realize that the inverse function of y from the very beginning is equal to x, and therefore we can write this expression here in this way here. So we have the density function of y, where y is a function of x, can be written immediately as the differential quotient dx dy of the density function for the random variable x. If we have, let me just fold up this lecture. In the case that we have a monotonically decreasing function instead of an increasing function, then the whole thing applies again, but here we need to change the sign. So if the function is monotonically decreasing instead of increasing, then we have to change the sign. And for this reason, the general result we can derive is based on the numerical value of this differential quotient, dx dy. So that applies for generally monotonic functions. And finally, we can generalize it to the situation where we are dealing with a vector of random variables. And in that case, I was not planning to give you any derivations at all anyway, but I wanted to give you the result, and you see it's very similar. If we have the density function of a random variable x as a starting point, then we can establish the probability density function of the random variable y, which are functions of the x's, in terms of the what we call the Jacobi matrix, defined through the differential quotients x to y, and where this sign here means the absolute value of the determinant of the Jacobi matrix. That's very good. Now, that was the absolutely last overhead for today. And I will wish you a nice week.